Hello, everybody. Welcome back to LPFWA, and my voice is almost normal again. I say almost here because not quite. But hey, here's some wrestling. It's gonna be good, I hope. If not, don't blame me. Even though I'm the only one who has any hand in it. But yeah, could be worse. And here we have our matches for the day. On screen shortly, I would hope. I make this show and it can't be asked to remember the match card. Gotta be honest. But oh yeah, here we have DCB versus Garble Barba, and DCB, of course, being the underdog in every match until she starts winning miraculously. And then we have Pelpy versus Annihilated for the Bunny Championship. Can you imagine Pelp with a Bunny Championship? I don't know. And of course, a long-awaited debut of Samus Aran versus Konami. And we have some more match for the newly renamed Pokemon's title, Talvi versus Chumpy Chan. And finally, our main event, a slasher villain versus a tree for the LP Superstar title. First, as usual though, we have our Buskus match. And, well, Lotus has held the title for, what now, 3 weeks, 4 weeks? Unfortunately, he's recently regained his fighting spirit, however, he didn't have any success yet. But maybe DCB can help. Because she's got some tricks up her sleeve. Not that she ever won a match or anything, but maybe she can help. Maybe. Because she has some coffee. Of course, everything is just written on it in black marker, because she doesn't have labels. You know, DCB is precious, she's just trying to help, and maybe it'll work, who knows? Maybe all Lotus needs is a little bit more energy. Which you can get from a brew of coffee that has enough caffeine to kill people. Let's hope Lotus doesn't die. Coffee is eternal. In fact, I'm drinking coffee right now. And Lotus goes up against Skier. Both of them have a 0% win percentage this season. So, I don't know. This should be even, I hope. If not, then, well, tough luck. But Lotus will get out of this hole eventually. I believe in Lotus. As I believe in DCB, that eventually they'll both go on like a really vicious winning streak, just killing it. I can dream, right? Now with confidence and coffee, Lotus might have a chance. If he can't win, I don't know what else he might need. It's tough sometimes. If I actually calculated power rankings for wrestlers based on title losses and stuff, Lotus would probably be in the negatives now. Hey, here's Gear, self-proclaimed King of Jobbers, who in Season 1, of course, had the catchphrase, as I'm keen to point out, he insists on being a jobber despite having a perfect record. Which was true for a while. This attire, by the way, is based off of Skier from Season 1. The only thing this attire doesn't have is the antenna on the head. Because it's actually based off of the protagonist from, I think, Tower of Heaven it's called. A little bit of a platformer with Game Boy aesthetics. During Season 1, his suit was at the dry cleaner, so he was an alien. Hey, let's see. Going off to a good start, Lotus is doing stuff. Yep, that was a move. That's better than usual. Well, that was fun while it lasted. Let's just see. Maybe Lotus can make a comeback after getting two moves in. Now getting hit twice, thrice, four times. Just gonna count. Okay, good. I gave up hope too soon. I should be more optimistic when it comes to Lotus. Aw yeah, that was a high impact move. Well, Sephir, you're quite right, especially if you're talking about matches from the likes of Phoenix, who usually gets in most of the offense in any given match. Not even one count. Yeah, Phoenix is in the offense in most matches, but always loses due to like one or three moves at the end by the opponent. It's quite frustrating. Same's true for Brock Lesnar matches. His opponents get in all the offense, and then Brock does like a couple suplexes and wins. Yep, we're going outside. Fighting dirt. Never mind. Every time they go outside, I hope they break the barricades. Even though I think, just going by gameplay terms, you can't really break the barricades in this arena type. That was 10. I can see it already. This isn't gonna end pretty, isn't it? But I believe. Because sometimes, all you can do is believe. But that knee to the face isn't exactly filling me with confidence. Yeah, Frody, you got it right. To quote the immortal Lucio, you gotta believe. Well, we have two Super Sentai, actually. Skier isn't one of them. The other one would be, Flamander. I hope that Lotus can get out of this hole he's somehow fallen into, and eventually he can face Flamander, who's the best Super Sentai. Did he just push Skier away just to taunt? Impressive. Impressive. Oh no, he's going for the finisher. Yep. Backstabber powerbomb. Ouch. And one, two, three. That's a little bit depressing, to be quite honest. But Lotus tried. Lotus did better than last week, I think? Maybe next week you can take it. Because I believe. Maybe next time. Next time Fruity will come to Lotus and tell him that he's gotta believe. Even though, well, Fruity's usually the one who has to be told to believe. At least if we're going by Fruity and my Rocket League experience. Man, Skier's such a heel. Doesn't even want the ref to raise his hand. What a jerk. Would you believe in New Japan Pro Wrestling, not having hand raised by the ref actually gives you some kind of heat? In WWE, no one really cares, to be quite honest. But now we have the same match again, only this time it's DZB instead of Lotus, who's trying to get out of a losing streak. Can DZB finally do it? Aw, yeah. That entrance will never get old. I'm gonna tell you, quite honestly, the original reason I picked this entrance is because the song is so short. It's like 30 seconds long. And most entrances are longer, but the Ultimate Warrior one isn't. I think DZB drank like 4 or 5 Black Label DZB specials at this point. Maybe she has a chance against Garbo Barba, who also has a 0% win percentage right now. Mainly because he's only had one match so far and lost it. Whatever happens here, someone actually gets their first win. Exciting. Much like last match where Skier got his first win of the season. Only this time it's DZB's first ever win. Like, she never actually, like, won a singles match, ever. It's sad, to be honest. Because DZB deserves a major push. But unfortunately, this isn't predetermined. Yes, don't buy WWE 2K18. Just don't. Oh man, DZB sounds strong! Could this be finally the one match? Oh yeah, straight out the gate. Never mind, it's over. She's dead. It's over. Hate to be so pessimistic, but I know what happened in the past. Actually, you know what? I gotta believe. I should continue believing. I should. The saddest part is that I didn't even make DZB intentionally bad or anything. I made her just as strong as everybody else. As I did last season, and she still keeps losing. But eventually, like, it can only be a matter of time. Given enough time, anyone can win a match, even if it takes them 3 years. Or 4. I don't know. I'm digging the Lufia 2 music in the background. Momentum shifts again, as it seems. And again? Oh wow! Holy shit! Did she just fling DZB into the corner? Now she's laughing? Wow. What a heel. Ah, well. That sure was a move. Caught me off guard. Wolf Rudy, you did at least win some matches in Season 1, and you were a superhero once. I still have to, at one point, make, like, some throwback episodes where I just throw together matches from Season 1 and people who've been there talk about it. Because I don't think a lot of people have seen anything in Season 1, and it's not really out there anymore. Plus, there's no commentary on them. It's quite shit. Anyway, talking about good stuff. This match. Oh, whoa. Oh. Is she? Yes! I wish I'd known this would happen so I could just turn the music off or fade it out while the crowd chants this is awesome. You can still hear it, of course, but I just love that DDT. The first time I ever saw it was when Sami Zayn did it to, I think, Cesaro? That was a match Chumpy showed me, actually. And yes, she did jump. She did actually jump, like, between the ring and the bottom rope. It's quite impressive. It's like an unnecessarily flashy move. Only one count. And by the way, that tornado DDT through the ropes counts as a finisher. Or more appropriately, a OMG move. Which requires a finisher. Alrighty. I believe in DZB. She could pull off that move. She can do it. Actually, I think this is her finisher. Taking out the trash. I hope this doesn't mean anything bad. Welp. She tried really hard and really well. She at least had the best moves. Don't worry though, her time will come eventually. Cause once we have enough women in LPFWA, like 16, I will probably start a tournament for the first ever women's champion. And I hope that DZB takes it, of course, or at least doesn't get eliminated first round. You know, Hal, sometimes the underdogs just have to lose, otherwise they wouldn't be underdogs. And sometimes they have to lose every match forever. Otherwise, they wouldn't be underdogs. I mean, yeah, Pelpy is up next. Maybe he'll win, or maybe Annihilated, who has a perfect singles record so far, will take it. I think it's a perfect record, I don't know. I could check my big-ass spreadsheets and everything, but yeah. And of course, Pelpy's coming in with his entourage, as signaled by the Aura 66 music. Well, Fruity, bad news. This isn't Pelpy's entrance. This is the Aura 66 entrance. Well, see, Pelpy is a heel, so he doesn't give us his entrance. Otherwise, we'd be happy. I hope WWE doesn't send us a cease and desist over the too sweet gesture in the video game, because that would be upsetting. You know what the worst part of this match is? We're not gonna see an Elite's normal entrance either, cause he's coming as a champ. Truly, both of those are heels. They actually are though, I think. TNT, I shouldn't sing. It's just I love that song, so I can't help it, I'm sorry. I love the championship interest in these games though. They weren't so cool in the previous games. Or at least in, like, I don't know how they were in 17, because I barely played 2K17, 16, and 15. In fact, they didn't play those at all, but 17 played a little, but yeah, not much. Oh, Frody, I've never seen you sing on stream, unfortunately. Maybe you should fix that. No one's twerking either, it's kind of upsetting. And here we go. Wow, this is metal as fuck already. Well, let's see if Palpy can win without the interference of his friends. The answer is probably no. What they also likes to do is to just randomly attack the opponent if their manager, which causes an instant DQ. So, yeah. That might happen. I mean, there was a time when twerking was kind of in, and WWE didn't do it. Oh yeah, he's going for something big, just the middle of rope. Oh my god, that could have been sweet. It wasn't, but it could have been. Oh, is this the double standing moonsault spot again? No, just one. Not even a one count. If he'd done two moonsaults, I'm pretty sure it would have been a one count at least. I don't know how, WWE was way ahead on the whole Trump choke thing. Also, they are disgustingly pretty big Trump supporters. Cause you know. Oh wow! Springboard moonsault to the outside, I didn't know he had that move. And just throwing Palpy onto the barricades, holy crap. It's almost like he wants to legitimately injure him. A I think that was 7. Ooh, the flashy lag drop. That might be a signature, I'm not sure. I don't think so. Oh! FaZe did something there. Which didn't really have any effect on anything in the match, except the ref looked away briefly. Maybe he should have thrown in the chair first. Oh! Palpico got thrown onto the chair, holy crap. Let's just pretend that is extra damage. Ooh, and now he distracts the ref from doing the pinfall, because every referee is obligated to just talk to whoever is at ringside if they just yell, "Yo, ref." That's how it works. No matter what's happening currently, just interrupt what you're doing. Even if you're in the middle of counting a pin, just go to the guy, say hello, and ban them from ringside, as the ref did with FaZe here. Rainmaker, holy shit. And now his move, the Sith, thing. That's his signature. Just resting in the corner and... he's actually doing it. This is the Galactic Elbow. I think this is the first time, or the second time we see it this season. And oh my god, he used the Force to readjust and annihilate it. That should be illegal, but the ref didn't see it. He was too busy taking out the chair. Palpy won by Force use, illegal. This shouldn't be. Look, Palpy forces a win. Again. Oh, well, good match though. Of course, with a little help from FaZe. I think Kylo just stood there, did nothing. Let's not use the same acronym from last week. Try to think of something clever and new. And Palpy holds the Bunny Championship up high as the new champion. Will the bunnies ever recover from this? I don't know. I really don't know. Could be worse, I think. Could be worse. Ooh, do I hear Metroid music? I think I do. Aw yeah, it's our buddy Chef Life, last seen at Anime Showdown. Doing some interviews. Ah, well. I think I like Samus already. Well, they say that Samus looks good, but there's an even more amazing one downloadable. Like, the one that's downloadable is actually legitimately, like, amazing. With custom logos and everything. Hey, DZB! Unfortunately, you lost your match again. Good thing you missed it. It was really good though, you did sick moves and everything. Eventually, you'll have it in the bag. Maybe that one more coffee is just what you need. I could just use custom logos for this Samus as well, but quite frankly, I'm a bit lazy. I mean, in addition to spending like 15 hours making the show every week, maybe I don't want to create custom textures to put on people. And here we have, of course, Konami Koda, who started out as the Kawaii Champ. Then lost it to Helena, but that's no shame, because Helena is kind of a monster. And then Konami actually kicked Nadira's face in. Alright, let's see it. Is it happening? This is Samus. Her signature move is actually the screw attack, which is a 630 senton. It's impressive. And the finish, of course, a triple power bomb, because why not? Hey, no, Konami deserves every win she could get, of course, just... Samus is the kind of competitor you would immediately put against a viable opponent, a really good, powerful, and of course, hopefully, equally good opponent. But of course, Samus is tall as fuck. Like, she's 190 centimeters tall. I'm 175 for reference. Not that you could see me right now, but yeah. I actually googled her height and weight, by the way. I forgot how heavy she is, though. But I got her weight right in game. I added a couple of pounds for the suit, but that's it. Ah, man, springboard elbow to the back of the helmet. But much like Samus said before the match, even though Konami is really good at kicking ass, Samus's ass is armored. Honestly, I just can't wait till we see the screw attack, because there's so many flips. Ah man, Konami's whipping out the big guns, just... suplex... to the apron. That is, as many people will try to remind you, the hardest part of the ring. The nice thing about Samus is that she is very athletic and also incredibly strong. Not the middle ground of the two, she just does all the flips and then melts her face off. Holy shit, Samus is huge, like, with Konami on top of her, It's just, I don't know. It's almost scary. It was just a normal flip, nothing special. I could do that, probably, with training. If I also lost some weight. Oh, this could be it. This could be the screw attack, her signature move. Aw, yes. And she's immediately following it up with a triple power bomb. Or at least she tried. Another one of Samus' moves is the bomb jump. It's a rolling thunder. And oh no, the Shoryuken. Of course, it's not that simple. Some more springboard shit. Ah, well, just another elbow. I love when people have springboard moves, because, you know. Leaps, punches, flips, wrestling action. Yeah, I like it too. I'll probably use it unless someone can come up with something much better. But holy crap, this is a good match so far. This is now officially Konami's comeback music. I mean, it fits, it's a Street Fighter track. And while she's not actually Ryu, or a female Ryu, she's a Shoto clone. Which is basically almost Ryu. Oh, Hadouken! Oh no, it's gonna be another Shoryuken. It's pretty hard to kick out of two finishers. One, two, and of course she kicks out. I mean, of course, I say. It's kind of a miracle, to be honest. And man, Konami is just relentless. She immediately follows up. Stunner. I didn't know I gave her a stunner. Konami kicks out with a one count. After a goddamn stunner. Ooh, another screw attack. Not even going for the finisher this time. There we go. Samus wins her debut. Those are a lot of flips, holy crap. Yeah, we didn't even get to see her finisher, the triple power bomb. Which, you know, it's a triple power bomb. It's three power bombs. I'm sure you can imagine it. Well, that was the match of the night so far, for me at least. I think Meltzer would give it like 3.5 stars or something. Ideally 5. 5 if it wasn't the Tokyo Dome, but this is on the moon and, you know. And I just realized we actually have 3 women's matches so far. This is a new record. Normally we have less, because there's not that many women yet, but we're getting more and more every day. Oh man, it's Talby against Chumpy Chan, and Chumpy Chan has her first match after, well, her debut, which she won. And Talby also has a flawless record. I think. I could be wrong. I'm a bit sad that Chumpy Chan right now is a champion, because her non-champion entrance is 4 minutes long. This one's only like 2.5, I think. Only. I miss gender swap John Cena somehow. I gave Evil, who was the gender swap John Cena, less like overall stat points last time than anybody else, and she still won. Almost every single time. Yeah, gender swap John Cena, aka Evil, actually lost the Kawhi title multiple times, but always won it back somehow. It was almost like real John Cena. What makes John Cena win are the 5 moves of Doom, obviously. Yeah. Actually, I didn't think of that, but John Cena is actually invisible. I might be cheating. of course, as decreed by Chumpy-chan. The rival music from Pokemon has to play every time somebody challenges for the Pokemon's title. Back in Season 1, the title had no name. Chumpy back then said, "Let's call the Pokemon's title," and they resisted that for a very long time. To such a degree that I called it Black Title, after the guy who held it the most. And oh my god. I'm glad that we got a twerk. I'm not so glad that it's also a panty shot at the same time. I am glad though that Chumpy gave herself like some kind of shorts under the skirt though to make it less offensive. Alrighty, let's see. How long was Chumpy's entrance again? Too long. I'll probably speed it up or something. Oh man, just kip up immediately, just showing off. Chumpy has a great moveset. Since she made herself, she of course handpicked her moves. I hope she didn't look up some list of the most OP moves ever and... Oh my god. Was that like a rolling, flying elbow? Oh my god. That looked weird. And a boot to the face. Some might call this a big boot, but it was more like, I don't know. It looked like she had to kick downwards because Chumpy's so small compared to Talvi. I think Talvi still isn't as tall as Samus. We'll have to see eventually. And a buckle bomb. Are we gonna see flips? Oh well. It's a run. I was hoping for flips though. Yes, just stand there. Stare at her. That's gonna help you. It's like psychological warfare or something. that was good. Of course, the big power moves. Immediately just crap on all the moves that Chumpy did in the meantime. Like that whiffed grab. And this might be her finisher. Yep, that's it. I mean, it might not be it, but that's the finisher. And she kicks out. As you would expect from Chumpy-chan, the most anime of LPFWA. Yeah, go make a proper comeback. Do some moves, Talvi. Some real hard ones. And of course a dab, why not? Oh, is this a John Cena comeback? It is. And she follows it up. Oh my god, this could only be better if she followed up with the Attitude Adjustment. Because this is the fourth move of the five moves of Doom, and the fifth one is the Attitude Adjustment. I guess a nice leg drop. That works too. Now we have the Shadow of Colossus music going on. It's almost like Chumpy is fighting against the Colossus. Just climbing the Great Colossus, Talvi, and trying to find her weak spot somewhere. Ooh, a superplex. Oh, she's deadlifting her. Ah, the ref is the horse. He can die. It doesn't matter. Chumpy just won't give up. Because not giving up is very anime. That was some kind of slam. Ah well. Might be a signature? I'm not even sure. I forget what everybody's signature is. Oh my god, she's going for the Muscle Buster again, isn't she? Oh yes, this is it. I mean, the Muscle Buster, not the end. Chumpy, be an anime, kick out! Ah, well. Sometimes the anime needs to lose to make the eventual return and victory even more impressive. Actually, this is also how wrestling works. Funny, huh? Doing a five-knuckle shuffle is also pretty anime. And now she is the new Pokemon's champion. Well, DCBS, if you actually win, finally, it's gonna be earth-shattering. I hope it happens at pay-per-view because... just because. You winning could main event the Tokyo Dome. Oh, what's this? There's a commotion backstage? Apparently someone's attacked Talby on her way back to the locker room. Rude. Let's get a camera right there. Aw, man, it's Helena. Just going against an opponent who's already exhausted. She must be really pissed she lost last week to some goth. So now she must beat up people who are actually strong. Like Talby. Of course, if Helena wins this, Talby will only have held the title for like a minute or two. Well, demons make for good anime villains, at least. I think. Aw, man. But hey, Talby's still fighting back, despite having had a match just a few moments ago. It's not like this has any effect on the match or anything, because they're always at full health at the start. Oh man, Talby just stumbling to the next, like, crate or whatever that is. Yeah, angry stomping. I can dig it. Just throwing her around like she's mad. I mean, she is mad. Oh, it's the main course, aka the move where she actually eats the opponent's face, and oh my god, that's it. And we have a new Pokemon's champion already. Ah. Well, rip. Indeed, rip. And hey, here we have our main event. D, the Destroyer, versus a tree, an actual tree. I mean, the bright side, this means that, Talby can't compete for any other title without becoming a double champion. Wait, that's not a good thing. Because being a double champion is sick. I really dig that song. Yeah, but DZB, chainsaws are not ring legal. That fucking Christmas tree song, goddamn. Stop. It's kind of fitting. We have December. Christmas is coming. Yeah. Maybe he can keep that title till Christmas. I mean, the belt doesn't look as cheap as the LPWA Championship belt, which is actually made of plastic. This one's at least made of some kind of metal and has, like, gems in it. I don't know. I just like the question mark there. It's almost like there's any doubt that this is an actual tree. No twerking from D here. Will the tree twerk? I don't know. Of course not. Trees can't twerk. Silly. Looks like everybody's booing for some reason. Well, looks like our slasher villain is coming strong out the gate with some moves. But hey, the tree's gonna prove that it's a tree. Are trees even allowed? Don't know why I'm asking that question now instead of like way earlier, but hey. Not even a one count. That guy just headbutted the tree and lived to tell the tale. I was hoping for the tree to go up the top rope and do like a dive attack to the outside, but yeah. Oh yeah, that's Ryu's theme actually, not Guile's. Guile's theme is like way more American stuff. If you put Guile's theme through a spectrogram reader, it actually just is an American flag. Looks like the tree is dominating so far, at least. Both of those guys came across as strong, like, before this match, so... Even though I think D lost all of his matches, except his debut. And, well, he only was in his debut than a tag match, so... So, yeah. So he won all singles matches at least, and oh man, this is, oh my, his signature. Will we see the Canadian space program? Oh yeah, I think we are. Ah yes. Going up high and crashing down. Just a two count though. Hey, did you ever try to pin a tree? It's really hard. Oh, that's his finisher. The tree falling. Well, no one's watching. Except the entire crowd, the ref, and the opponent. At this stage, anything goes, especially just waiting in the ring doing nothing. Oh man, he just threw the tree straight into the camera. That's kind of impressive. And they always go back at the 7 count, it seems. I think I've discovered a pattern. Wow, man, looks like D is really exhausted right now. Which is fair, he's been thrown around by a tree a lot. I thought he was going for some superplex or something. And because the tree is a super heavyweight, there's a chance that the ring will break. And yeah, he reversed the move, the thing. Oh my, the tree falling distance again. Well, no one's watching, except the entire crowd and the ref and the opponent. And the tree retains. And yeah, DCB, I got that texture by just googling tree bark. And then importing it into the game. That's all I did. Maybe I should just mute the audio in the future when the tree is falling. Sure is expressive for a tree. Oh, well. No, there's still a bonus match to come. Which is Samus versus Bayley. It was actually tied with Dash Render versus Ric Flair. So I had to, you know, break the tie. But here we are. Samus versus Bayley. At, I think, the SmackDown 2000 arena? Yep, here's Samus again. It's the first night she's wrestling, and she already has her second match. Though this isn't technically canon. Yeah, I mean, Bayley is something special. I just wish that main roster didn't basically ruin her. I'd like to say that Fruity had the hugger gimmick before Bayley, but first of all, it doesn't matter. And I think Bayley might have done it in 2013 already. Yeah, you're right. Let's do it. Let's make it happen. Alright, here we go. Samus versus Bayley. Stunner right off the bat. Nice. Now those are some good moves. Yes, Samus is tall. Surprise. And, well, this is the triple powerbomb already. That's main roster Bayley. Main roster Bayley. Main roster Bayley. But you know, since I had to break the tie, I decided to also have Dash Render versus Ric Flair, so we're gonna have another match. Mainly because this one was so laughably short. We really should have gotten NXT Bayley, yeah. Let's go to the beach. Yes, that was a squash. The game does squashes sometimes, it's quite good. Like, remember when I squashed Lotus? That was hilarious. It was brutal. Here's my eternal nemesis, Dash Rendar. Who stole all my booze? Forever. It's a miracle he can walk straight. Well, I guess with his weight he can handle more, I don't know. Is the crowd chanting "eat shit"? I don't think it would, because they wouldn't let the crowd curse. There's not even holy shit chants in this game. That's Dash's big meaty fists. I just love Dash basking in the glory of Ric Flair's theme. I, for one, am hoping that Dash Rendar taps to the figure four leg lock. Dash at the beach, indeed. Yeah, it's 91 Ric Flair. I think the only other Ric Flair in the game is like one from the 80s. Like, yeah, there's two Ric Flairs in the game. But don't worry, he's not wearing the red trunks. That means he's gonna win. Because, little known fact, or in fact, well known fact, Ric Flair always loses when he's wearing red. Oh shit, his boots have red. Oh man. I'm torn now. Ric Flair is, of course, well, he's so legendary that I couldn't really describe him as Ric Flair from WWE, but instead as Ric Flair from wrestling. Mainly because he's had the best run, like, not in WWE, but before that. Like, in early WCW, probably. Not that I know, I didn't watch all of that, but it would make sense. Suitably epic music for this fight, though. I hope that Ric Flair can do like the Ric Flair belly flop in this game. Ooh, just deadlifting the Nature Boy twice in a row. Well, thankfully, we all know that Hulk Hogan is a piece of shit. One and, just a one count. I was hoping that'd be enough, just to embarrass Flair a bit. I mean, not Flair. Let's not embarrass Flair. Well, let's embarrass Dash at the beach. Oh yeah, oh, wow, I didn't know Flair could do that move. I'm not used to him just throwing people around. Especially not like Dash. Oh, near fall. Do it, Flair, you can do it. Oh, yes! He's going for the figure four, I think? Oh, yeah, he could do it from standing, yeah, that's nice. Yes! This is the first time in a while that a non-LPFWA wrestler actually, like, wins their match. The only other time was when Asuka beat DZB. Well, what can I do next to bury Dash? I guess a last Ric Flair isn't exactly burying him. Oh well, I'll think of something. I think the crowd just booed Ric Flair, which makes sense because he's a heel, but he's also Ric Flair. He should just elbow drop on a suit jacket now, because... Just cuz. There should be an elbow drop on a suit jacket entrance in this game, but there isn't. Mainly because that was a much older Ric Flair. Let us fade to black for like 20 more seconds, I think. It's a long fade, but it's worth it for listening some more to the Nature Boys' nice little music, which of course you can't hear anymore over my voice because my voice is too loud and the music is too quiet. But anyway, that's been the show. My match of the day is probably still Konami versus Samus. That was really good. But for the time being, I think I'll just bid you farewell. Goodbye. Mwah. And good night. Bang. I think I did that last time. I was soloing it. Oh, it doesn't matter. See ya.